with React 18.2 and Next.js 13, we got a new use hook, and with it, the potential of doing something cool like this inside of our data fetching components, where we just put a fetch inside of a use, just like that. And then use, which monitors promises, will give us our data, and that makes our components super clean. But when I tried to do that back a couple months ago, this particular code would cause an infinite loop of requests immediately and render nothing. And when I put that into a video, folks said, oh, wait, just you wait. There's going to be a cache function that comes out in React, and it's going to fix everything and give us this cool use fetch pattern. Well, cache is out. So let's go into Next.js 13, try it out, and see if it actually does fix this. And in the process, get a really interesting new way of, again, sharing data within our React tree between components in different spots. Oh, and by the way, before I forget, I just want to say thank you to the Next.js team who stepped up on Twitter to help me out yesterday, walk through some of these issues. I really appreciate that. Thank you so much for that support. All right, let's jump right into it. This isn't going to be one of those videos where we make some cool new project. In this one, we're literally just going to look at the primitives of stuff and see how it all works. So to do that, we're going to need a Next.js 13 application. So I'll create that using npx create next app with Next.js React Cache as the name. That's going to be the name in GitHub in the link in the description right down below. So you can get access to all that source code, of course, for free. And we want to use the experimental app directory so we get all the cool new stuff. All right, let's try this out. TypeScript, ESLint, source, yes, please. And the import alias, which is going to give us @, and that is the import for source. So anything after that, you get a source file. Cool, awesome. Okay, let's bring that up in VS Code. Now we are going to be doing a lot of fetching in this one, so I'm going to go create some data over here in public. I've got three different customers, 1.json, 2.json, 3.json, that have some fields in them, first name, last name, job, email, and so forth. So this is what we're going to get by just doing /1.json in the code. And also I've gotten some feedback that folks don't like it when I switch between a black VS Code and a white browser screen. So I'm going to go and put in some CSS, which is going to make it nice and dark for us. All right, now I'll go over to page.tsx and pare that down to just the basics. Now, this is a React server component. You can't use hooks in a React server component, and we want to use the use hook. So I need to turn this into a client or hybrid component, whichever way you want to say it. To do that, I need to say use client. And then I can bring in the use hook. All right, let's fire this up. All right, now that's on port 3000, which is good to know. And it got a nice blank black page. Cool. All right, so now we won't get that nasty flickering back and forth. So, okay. So we're going to get data from use. And use is going to use a fetch. And we'll go and get number1.json, and then we'll put that out as data. Okay, let's check. Hey, nice. Okay. So let's go check out the network and see what's going on. If I hit refresh, you can see that we have 1.json. That's really cool. So what's happening here is that Next.js has wrapped the native fetch and replaced it with a fetch wrapped in cache. And we'll get into what the cache function is and how it works. And that's something to know. Apparently, it is an opt-out thing, so you can not do that if you don't want their cached version of fetch. But here's an interesting thing. If I go back over to the code, and let's say I make one little change, adding a query parameter on there, right? This is no problem. We're still going to get back the data. I'm going to hit save. If I go back over to Arc, we can see
ha! Boom, baby!
Infinite loop of requests. Not great, right? So this is exactly what we were seeing before with the old use. So I'm going to actually go back over into my Visual Studio Code and disable this as quickly as I can, so I don't take down my browser. So what happened? Well, what happens is every time we render home, we get a new promise, reference, coming out of fetch and then the then. And that goes off to use. Use says, oh, I have a different promise now. So I'm going to await that. And then we would then render. And then that promise resolves. We get data again. And then that starts a re-render cycle again. And so we get an infinite loop of request because, yes, the fetch is the same, but the promise reference coming back is different each time, and therefore we get the infinite loop. If you're new to this channel, you probably haven't heard me say this before, but references and understanding them is key to understanding JavaScript and TypeScript and React. It's never about the content of the array, object, or function, or promise in this case. It's about the reference to it. So I think we can fix this with cache. But that's because I know what cache does. Not sure you do, so let's go through what cache does. Let's bring it in. So cache takes a function. We'll create a new function, let's call it adder. It's gonna take two values, A and B, and add them together. And you know what, let's just do that a bunch of times. We'll do 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, 6, and I'll hit refresh. And so I have 3, 7, and 11 over in the browser, cool. And let's put in a console log here so we can see how many times it was actually run. All right, so using the free VS Code extension Console Ninja, I can see that we got 3 invocations here, 1 for 5, 6, 1 for 3, 4, and 1 for 1, 2. Exactly as we would expect. Awesome. So let's try this again. Let's do a bunch of these. And let's save. That's going to cause Arc to refresh, which is going to make the request again, which is going to generate our console. And we can see now that we got 12 requests. I guess I copy and pasted it 3, 4 times, whatever. So now we have 12 of them. All right, so if we were to take this function now and wrap it in cache, what we expect is to go back to 3. So what cache does is it takes a function and it returns a function that wraps it. And for every invocation, it looks at the incoming arguments, in this case, like 1, 2, whatever, and it looks to see, have I seen that before? And if it has seen it before, then it returns the value that it stored from before. If it hasn't seen it, then it runs it, stores that value, and returns the new value. And that way, we should only get 3 invocations here. Let's try it out. There we go, 3, awesome. So what we now have in React Cache is a very standard memoization function. And this is where we get into the world of naming, because we had a memo function, and now we've got a cache function, except that the memo function wasn't really ever a memoization function. It was a way to mark components as kind of memoized, except that it was only a one-level memo. This new cache is actually a true memoization, and the original memo is more like a cache, and okay, anyway, we just have to know that this is what this does. Cache takes a function and returns a memoized function. Sorry, naming. But we don't care about adding numbers together, do we? So let's get rid of this adder stuff. And let's go and wrap our fetch in this cache. So we'll call this fetch user. And we'll replace the contents here with our fetch. We'll take an ID, which is a number. We'll turn that into a string template. And we will use that ID as the number for the request. Okay, looks pretty good. So now let's go back and try this out and see if we blow up again. So we'll uncomment this and then bring in our fetch user, give it ID 2 in this case. Now we've got our data and let's bring back our JSON Stringify. Okay, looks good. And let's inspect that, see, go over to our network. And now we only get our 2.json request once. Which is really cool. Originally, when we were looking at this, we got the JSON request twice. And that's because we are in the strict mode and we're getting mounted, unmounted, and remounted on the client. So now we're not only just getting one request, but we're actually only getting one request, really, even with React strict mode. Okay, let's try and do my little thing here where I add on the query parameter. See if that hurts it. Hit save. Going back into Arc. Nope. Looks just fine. Solid as a rock. Yes! I love it. Except that we've had to do the work. So, yes. Did cache, save, use? I guess. Okay. Anyway. All right. Moving on. So what I want to do is I want to have two different components. I want to have first name and I want to have last name. First in this case would show Jamie. Last in this case would show Lee. And I want to get it from a single user. So how are we going to do that? Well, let's go and build our components first. I'll create a new directory called components. And into there, I'll create a first name component. So we're going to get some data somewhere. We get an ID. We got to get that data. So let's go and bring that in from page. We'll just bring the whole thing in. Cool. So now we have basically exactly what was on page, except that we have first name now. And we're only looking at the first. All right, let's go and bring this into our page. And we got to give it the ID. And there we go. Cool. All right. Let's go and do the same thing for last name. And we'll go over and bring it in. Awesome. Oops. Still say first. Okay. Let's go back over here to our last. All right, so that worked, but we are getting two requests. So why is that the case? Well, what the deal is you might be like, well, wait a second. They're working off the same cached function, right? No, they're not. They're not working off the same cached function because we're creating fetch user here and we're creating fetch user here. They are exactly the same implementation. They're not the same reference. So what we need to do is have them share the actual fetch user function. So let's go do that. So I'm going to go and extract fetch user here into a lib directory. We'll create a new file in there called fetch user. Need to bring in cache and export that. Okie dokie, let's go over here. Get rid of our fetch user. And then also bring in here for first name. Awesome. Now let's try it again. And now we get a single request because we're using the same fetch user in both places. Isn't that cool though? So here we go. Let's go back and take a look at the code. We've got up here at the page directory, we aren't sharing anything between these two. There's no global store manager. There's no context. There's none of that. And yet we're making a single request, but getting back data that runs both of those components. And it's a new way to think about sharing state in different parts of the React tree. Where we used to use something like a global state manager or context, now we can think about just having a shared cached API request system where it just dedupes the requests automatically for you. How cool is that? But what if we wanted up here to not actually have to pass in ID? What if we wanted to actually have that be through context, really? Let's create some context so we can pass down the ID to first and last name. And we can kind of get the sense of, if you were to use context, what you now have to put into context, which is less than what you had to before. All right, let's go and create user ID context. All right, I'm just going to bring in an implementation for us. We create a context. It's going to have just the one number, the user ID. And then it's going to give us back a component, which we can then use, user ID provider. We give it the user ID. We wrap children in it. And we pass along the value. And then we can use the use user ID hook to get the user ID. All right, let's try this out. We'll give it a user ID of 3 this time. And then we'll take out these IDs. Now go over into our first name and last name. take out the requirement for the user ID. And we'll bring in our custom hook to get the user ID. Drop that in there. And so here's an interesting point. So user ID, we default to null over in our context, right? So we set up a null here. And the output of use user ID can be either a number or null. So what do we do here? Because we don't want to fetch a user if that's null. This is where one of the interesting parts about the use hook in particular comes in. The use hook in particular can be conditional. So we can do something like this. We can say, we'll get the ID. And if there's no ID, we just return null. Otherwise, we go on to our fetch user. This would have been a no-no with any other hook, because the rules of hook state that you always have to have the same number of hook invocations on every single render of the component. But the use hook actually doesn't require that. So we can do cool conditional hooks like this. Awesome. Let's go over and just basically copy again this into last, since there's a lot of revisions, and then change that around again to last name. Okay, let's see. Ta-da! Works just great. And to test it out just a little bit further to show you how this caching works, I'm going to go bring in some buttons that allow us to flip between 1, 2, and 3. So I need some state for that. I need to have that user ID as state. Start off at 1, say. And then I'll paste in a bunch of buttons. And then one last thing, I need to actually use that user ID. Okay, there we go. Let's go back into our arc, hit refresh. And we start off with Sally Jones. Awesome. So we get 1.json, 2.json, 3.json. But now what happens if I go back to 1.json again? No difference. Why is that? Well, what's happening is that cache, because it's getting exactly the same ID as it did before, is giving us back exactly the same promise. And when we ask that promise to resolve, it's just giving us back that data. It is, in fact, a true cache, which is really cool. So let's think about this from the application architecture perspective for just a second. We have a context. That context has, in this case, just the ID of the user in it. And then we have this fetch user, which allows us to go and make that service call, but do it in a cached way. Now let's compare that to what we would have had to have done without cache, assuming we just had context. We would have had to take all of the data from this fetch user and put that into the context as well. So the context would have had the user ID plus the first name, last name, email, whatever. And now we can just have the shared piece of data, that one little piece of state, that user ID. And when it comes to getting specific data, we can make service requests like this and be sure that they're cached, and we'll always be able to get efficiency when it comes to our request to the server. Pretty awesome. Now, if you notice, I'm not doing anything on the server side here. And there actually is a bunch of stuff on the server side around this. Doesn't use use, obviously, but does use that cached fetch in a way very similar to this. And so if you're interested in that, please put in the comment section down below that you want to see how this works on the server. In summary, we've taken a look at the new use hook. We've taken a look at the new cache function that you can then wrap fetches with. Fetch, of course, is wrapped, but it doesn't seem to give us that use fetch functionality that folks were looking for. Honestly, I'm not looking for that. I think I would rather use query or use SWR for that, because those have extra stuff like, did we get an error? Are we still loading the refetch stuff? All of the mutation stuff. It's just a much better interface. I think use fetch is a cool idea, but it really only works in the happy path case, and it doesn't give us a whole bunch of extra functionality. So I'm probably going to leave it alone, even if we got it. But I do think that this cache used responsibly is very, very cool. I do think, though, that in a spa context, when you have a long running session, figuring out how to invalidate parts of this cache are going to be really important. All right. Well, I hope you got a lot out of this. If you did, please hit that like button. If you really did, please hit that subscribe button and click on that bell, and you'll be notified the next time a new Blue Collar Coder comes out.